Well, hello there, humans, aliens, whatever you are.
Weirdos,
losers,
dweebs.
We are the losers. This is my friend.
My name is Marshall.
I'm Corey.
Yeah, he's a nice guy.
Most of the time. Thanks for joining us today. We are so excited because Logan has just come out.
Yes. In light of the Logan film having been released, we thought it'd be a great time to maybe recap some of the films that had come out since 2000, I believe. 17 years to date, X-Men franchise.
Crazy.
All under Fox.
2000. Maybe 17 years.
Just kidding. Yeah. So in light of Logan coming out.
You talk more. I don't really make sense when I talk.
All right, great. Well, okay. Since Logan is now out in theaters, we thought it'd be great to go back over the last 17 years of the 9 or 10 X-Men titles that have been released.
There have been 10 X-Men films.
Including Deadpool, right?
Including Deadpool.
Okay. And I'm sure we'll talk about that film in a little bit.
Yeah.
Because it's on our list that we made.
Yes,
Yes.
Sorry?
No, I was going to say, speaking of our list, we... Corey and myself both compiled a list of the 10 films ranked from 10 to 1 of the films that we both personally enjoy the most.
Right. I'm very excited to hear your list.
I am as well. I actually want to see how much in common we have on our list, because I feel like we both like this stuff a lot, but I feel like we both look for really different things.
You know, yeah, I honestly, after making this list, I thought I liked these movies more. I don't know. For every good X-Men film, I think there was one that disappointed. As I'll dive into my list.
I felt like when I was compiling my list on the clock at work today, that don't tell my boss.
That is work.
Sometimes it feels like it. It's how hard the list was. I felt like there were 4 films that I thought were actually good X-Men films.
Yeah.
Out of the 9.
Ten. Looking at my list right here.
Okay.
I can say there's...
Mine's not digital like yours.
Most of them are pretty solid. I mean, they've done a good job.
Yeah.
For the most part.
I think so. I mean, clearly Fox knows what they're doing.
What I said earlier.
Clearly Fox knows what they're doing. You know, they've brought in $4.5 billion, and the movies have only been budgeted, all 10 together, at $1.5 billion. So they're doing something right. I don't feel as snazzy as you, though. You have a digital list. I wrote mine down on paper. Actually, Microsoft Word. Have you heard of it?
That old stuff?
Yeah, I wrote it down.
Wow.
And then I made a list.
Tree killer.
Yeah, but it really gave me a chance to go. Don't look at my list. You're cheating. Oh, my God. If you see the number 1, you are going to.
So, obviously, you guys probably know this. The Fox, you know, X-Men universe is set apart from the Marvel universe.
Yes.
In movies, at least. Obviously. Do you like that? Do you like that it's separate from... Because for me, I like that Marvel is... Or that X-Men is separate from, you know, the MCU. All the Marvel films. Because it lets it do its own thing. The X-Men universe is kind of like really big on its own. There's a lot of characters.
It is. It's
and,
huge.
And you know, the first X-Men film was like an Avengers film before we even got Avengers.
It's galactically big. They were one of the first teams in Marvel to ever even incorporate space and villains from space. So there's just a multitude of characters. And one of the things that I like that you pointed on was that you enjoy that they're separate. And my reasoning for that is X-Men has always been paralleled to, I guess, the social struggles of the times. And so you deal with the X-Men with a lot of mature themes that you don't get.
I love that part. A bit in the movies.
And it's nothing to say that, you know, the other Marvel movies don't have, you know, some mature content that you can glean from. But the X-Men films have, you know, potentially genocide and persecution and eugenics and all these very mature things that, you know, have happened in the real world, which they parallel oftentimes. Mm-hmm. That would be a video for another time maybe, but which I think separates them and sets them apart. And, you know, I don't want to go far into it because I know that that's a big theme why I think, you know, we'll talk about Logan later.
We'll get into that more when we discuss
I'll talk more about that when we talk about Logan. But let's just jump into the list. I want to hear.
All right. So,
hey, why don't you go first? You talk first.
I see that you have 9 on your list. Do you know where you'll fit Logan?
Yeah, I know where I'm going to fit Logan.
Great.
Yeah, we had a fight about it earlier. There's a custody battle.
It was full of claws and blood. Hashtag. Red claws.
Don't do that. That's so bad. Okay. All right. Don't look. Seriously, don't look at my list. I can't hide it like your computer.
Oh, yeah, I know.
Over there.
I'm not. Okay. Peeking. All right. Okay. Number 10. Boom. For me, I have X-Men Origins Wolverine.
Okay. You go talk about it.
This film is, well, the worst of the X-Men.
I can't even contain it. It's 5'10" too. It's so bad.
It's pretty bad. Yeah. I mean, obviously, there's another film that kind of redeemed a part of this film. Deadpool. You know?
Yeah.
What they did with the character Deadpool, they sewed his mouth shut. Yeah. That's the opposite of what you're supposed to do.
Yeah. And I love that's not even the focal part of the film, and that's the thing we all remember, yeah, is that they showed Deadpool's mouth.
Well, he is the
shut.
Main. I mean, the main boss fight at the end.
Yeah, I guess so. Yeah,
is him
with Sabretooth.
Yeah,
which I actually thought was a good casting in Origins.
Yeah,
yeah, I thought that
it's not all horrible.
Yeah, that even I mean, there's something to say that, you know, when these movies come out when we're younger, that we overlook some things because we don't enjoy, you know, cinema to the same level as when we're, I guess, a little bit older. Or we just look at it differently, you know? You're not looking for the same mistakes, same things.
Yep.
And one of the things I remember as a kid that I wanted to talk about on this episode was that the bathroom scene claws, the adamantium claws that come out when he's in the bathroom at the farmhouse with that nice, you know, homie couple. The CGI is so bad. And, I mean, I remember he's holding him up and he's looking at him. And I swear, it looks like a Nintendo 64 game. It looks really bad.
Honestly, I need to go back and watch this movie again.
And like,
maybe.
And the sparks that come from when he hits them together kind of look like if he's in Adobe After Effects using some default spark structure or something
like
that.
After Effects is pretty good.
No, it's great. But I mean, I'm talking about the default. It's bad. All right.
Yeah.
I guess we kind of talked about my number 10 too. This film is just bottom of the list for me.
My number nine was actually X-Men Apocalypse.
I had to remember.
I almost put it as number 10 for me. I just, man, this movie really disappointed me.
I remember we saw it together.
Yeah.
And we both, I mean.
I don't think.
Yeah, we did.
I don't think we did.
Yeah, we did. Go ahead.
Okay. anyways, I think it disappointed me so much because I loved Days of Future Past, like. And First Class,
I can see
just kind of gave it new energy, and so my hopes were very high for Apocalypse, and I was kind of bored most of the way through. Apocalypse, they were up on that hill for a long time, with Professor X. He wasn't a very fleshed out villain. Like, I feel like they could have done a lot more with him.
You mean Apocalypse?
Apocalypse.
Yeah.
What did I say?
No, I 100% agree.
Yeah.
I think that.
But it wasn't all bad. I mean, that Quicksilver scene was great.
Yeah. It's the most redeeming shot in the film, I would even say. Yeah. That was great. It's what everyone talked about after the theaters. Like, oh, yeah, but the Quicksilver scene.
But I still like the one in Days of Future Past much more. What was your number 9?
My number 9, I swear this isn't planned. My number 9 is X-Men Apocalypse.
Okay.
I 100% agree. Yeah. This was almost my number 10 because I remember, you know, when we got out of the theaters, I went back to my car so angry because, you know, watching the 90s TV show, this was the story arc in the 90s TV show with Apocalypse. And I was like, I love this villain. I had really high hopes for this villain. And seeing Magneto, you know, the Brotherhood, you know, team up with, Xavier's X-Men. And then they also did something that I cannot forgive them for, which was in the last, like, 10 minutes of the film, they ruined the Phoenix saga again.
Well,
in 5 minutes, they did it. And
I kind of feel like that was foreshadowing.
I know, and I will defend this. I will defend the movie to a degree, saying that I understand that the cinematic universe doesn't follow the script of the comics, and that's totally fine. I like that they're separate because you can do something else.
What you're saying is you want a good Phoenix saga,
but that's the thing,
because of,
and I'm sure many of our losers out here would agree that the Phoenix saga is arguably the best, or in the top three, four even, best X-Men run ever, and it's a very important story, and they've screwed the pooch twice. We'll get to the last stand, folks. We'll get to the last stand. It might be me next. I don't know.
Box. See. But, okay, number 8. Go ahead.
I'll do my number
probably
eight.
The same. I don't see.
My number eight is The Last Stand. X-Men The Last Stand.
There you go.
I thought that's what was next. For the same
Speaking
reason
of the Phoenix saga.
Which is for the reason that I just said is that they ruined the Phoenix saga to me. I didn't like the whole I did like the appeal of the X-Men having this temptation of, you know, there's this pharmaceutical company that's producing a mutant gene suppressing vaccine that you can go get. And that, you know, for people like Mystique or Rogue who really struggle with, you know, physical acceptance, that would be an appealing thing for them. And I thought that was a cool struggle in the film. But,
you know, I think for me, what bothers me about The Last Stand, from what I remember, I need to go back and rewatch all these, but
yeah,
this guy right here.
Yeah, he's killed in the first 10
minutes. What the heck?
Which is my favorite X-Men of all time. I believe it's yours as well, right? Is this your favorite X-Men of all time?
I mean, top three.
Yeah.
For sure.
I mean,
Cyclops, really, he hasn't had his big moment in any of the X-Men films, really.
And I feel like The Last Stand, with the relation to Jean Grey being such a focal point of the movie, mm-hmm. could have been a great opportunity for Scott to really shine.
He gets killed off in like the first act.
Yeah, which I thought was a mistake.
Yeah. So yeah, that was my number eight, by the way, as well.
Yeah.
Was The Last Stand. Number seven is The Wolverine. Okay. This movie, I don't even know if I saw this in theaters. Honestly, I didn't think it looked good. It turned out being okay, I thought.
Yeah, I have good memories of it.
Yeah.
But I don't remember watching it.
Right.
Yeah.
It's just kind of forgettable, right?
Kind of, yeah.
I mean, there's the train sequence, right? Isn't that the big big action thing? And the, the ninjas with the...
All like the
the arrows with the
like all the ninjas and the yakuza chasing them. Yeah,
I don't
know, I thought.
And then the silver samurai.
Yeah, silver samurai.
That's one of the villains, right?
Big baddie at the end. Yeah,
yeah.
His buddy that he rescues. And
what was cool about the Wolverine was the whole thing where he's losing his powers, right?
Yeah, he's not able to regenerate as fast anymore, right?
Yeah,
and I think to this point, that was the first time we've really seen that in any of the X-Men films, which is a really common theme that Wolverine starts to deal with, you know, as a mature comic book character later on in the comics. So I thought it was cool they incorporated that.
Mm-hmm. What else did you like about?
My number seven is the same. It's the Wolverine.
Yeah.
And don't look at the rest of the list.
Okay.
I swear you're sneaking peeks. If this goes on a podcast, it's going to sound bad. All right. I thought the Wolverine was when I think of it in my mind, I know that it was okay, but I can't remember that much about it.
Yeah. I only saw it once.
Yeah, it felt like The Last Samurai to me.
You don't like The Last Samurai?
I love The Last Samurai, but I felt like it was kind of like a Wolverine edition of The Last Samurai.
Yeah.
Hugh Jackman was Tom Cruise.
The Last Wolverine.
The Last Wolverine. It sounds like a, you know, World Wildlife Foundation like promo or something like that.
We should start it.
Yeah, they might be going extinct.
The Last Wolverine.
All right, let's move on. I can't believe
email us to we've support been tit this for tat cause. So far.
Are we only on six? It feels like forever.
We're gonna
there's gonna be a lot of editing to do. My God.
No, okay. We're good. We're just chilling.
All right, just don't look at my list. Just don't look at the list. Okay, go on.
All right. You say your number six.
All right, my number six is X-Men, the original one.
Boom.
2000. Nice. Same?
That's mine.
Oh, my God. I swear. This is
crazy.
This is
wow.
not scripted. I'm actually kind of surprised because I feel like, I said in the beginning of the of the recording, I feel like we have different opinions on some of this stuff. But, wow. Okay. Anyway. I thought the original X-Men film was really good. I mean, dude, I was a kid. I was 10 years old when I saw this. And, go ahead.
Sorry. Go ahead. I was cutting you off.
Yeah. This is my turn. Okay.
Go ahead.
Yeah. No, you know, I was 10 years old when I saw this. You were probably what?
Mm-hmm.
You were eight?
Eight.
Yeah, I was 10 years old when I saw this. And this movie really was the first big X-Men, superhero movie
Isn't
in general.
Isn't that crazy? 17 years ago.
Yeah, 17 years ago. It's
unbelievable.
Yeah, and it really kicked off the whole superhero movie genre.
I know.
Or at least doing it well. Mm-hmm. And I remember my parents taking me and my brother to see it, and we really liked it. But mm-hmm. now I have seen it again in the last year, at least within the last year, and even as an adult,
yeah,
I think the film holds up.
No, it does hold up. I mean, especially when you think about when it came out.
Yeah.
2000, right after that, I think Spider-Man came out.
Yeah, Tobey Maguire's Spider-Man, yeah.
I think that same year or a year later.
Yeah, Sony's Spider-Man.
Yeah, it really, like, I think...
Ooh, we could do comic book history, because that's right. Marvel around this time was selling off their rights of X-Men to Fox.
There you go.
And Spider-Man to Sony.
Yeah, but you're right. It really kicked off the comic book genre.
Yes.
I think people had a bad taste in their mouth, probably from... you know, those Batman films that were horrible. Batman and Robin.
Oh, yeah. I mean, we could do a whole series on that.
Yeah.
I haven't seen them in a long time.
I mean, also, it's a superhero ensemble film. Yeah. You know, everyone thinks of, oh, the Avengers was the first one with a bunch of heroes, got to see them on screen. Not really. I mean, look at the first X-Men.
They had at least one.
And they handled it very well.
Yeah.
Yeah.
At least 15 recognizable characters mm-hmm. that I can think of.
Yep.
Don't hold me.
And whenever I think of the original X-Men film, I think of the Statue of Liberty.
Yeah. They reference it in Logan that we'll get to.
Yes, they do. Spoilers.
Yeah.
Hello.
Is this a spoiler video?
No. Not for Logan.
What?
Not for Logan.
I honestly don't think I can do that. Talk about something spoiler free. I'm just gonna mumble.
Spoiler free, everyone.
Okay, spoiler free. Okay,
all right, cool.
Yeah, so that's our number six,
number
right? Number five
for me is Logan. That was supposed to be a drum roll. Oh, it's Logan. This is where I think it's probably different than yours.
Yeah.
It takes me a while to soak in everything.
Yeah. I feel like it's hard to describe sense. Talking about Logan on our list without revealing too much about why.
I just want to say the more I've thought about this movie, the more I've come to like it in just the last 24 hours.
Yes.
And it is very good. Trust me. If you're a fan of Wolverine
mm-hmm.
Or X-Men or, like, you know, if you like good films, like, it's just a good movie. So
yes,
we definitely recommend seeing it. Check out our review up right now, actually.
Yeah, so exactly.
Head on over there.
All right, perfect.
Okay, so your number five.
It's a lot of editing to do tonight, okay? My number five is actually Deadpool. Deadpool is where it is next for me on the list.
Mm-hmm.
And the only reason, you know, I know that Deadpool is, like, you know, one of the highest grossing rated R films of all time, and that it was a really good superhero movie, and because it had the rated R rating, it, you know, was really able to do what they wanted to do. But the reason it's not higher for me on the list, even though I know it was great and was even nominated for a Golden Globe in the musical / comedy category against La La Land, weird, is because I don't really have a connection to Deadpool. My first time I ever learned about Deadpool was when I played Marvel Ultimate Alliance. Do you know what that is?
Yes.
Yeah.
Great game.
Great game. I hear it's really expensive to buy now. Like, it's a cult. Really? It has, like, a cult following. Yeah. Like, the game. I don't even know. You can go check it out on Amazon. I might be wrong. I just heard that.
Yeah. Character you would want to play with.
Yeah, but that's the first time I saw him. And as, you know, as an avid X-Men reader through my teens, I was surprised I never really read more of him.
Yeah.
And
that's funny. The first time I heard of him was that same game, and my little brother actually loved playing as him.
Really? Okay. So. Was he funny in the game? I don't remember.
He was pretty funny. I think they had dialogue.
I didn't notice. I think I was too busy looking at Scott's butt. What? Oh, okay.
What? Scott Summers?
He's cut off at the torso, so you can't see.
Yeah.
Okay. There's a statue.
Anyways,
on the podcast.
Okay. Awkward.
Yeah. All right. Why don't you go next?
Who's Scott? Scott's our
Scott
cameraman.
Summers, Cyclops. Oh, God. Okay. All right, go on.
Come on, Marshall.
Next.
My number four, right? Are we on four?
I think we're on four. Let me check. Yeah, we're on number four.
Four was X-Men First Class. When this one came out, I loved it. I know people were complaining about how Beast looked in it.
Was this the first
time? It wasn't a big deal to me, but seeing McAvoy as Professor X was perfect.
Yeah.
And especially Michael Fassbender. I was blown away by what a great job he did as Magneto.
I would say the best.
And just seeing the origin of
the Brotherhood, like, and the X-Men.
Well, their relationship of Professor X and Magneto, how they started out friends. I love that.
Yeah.
That whole dynamic. And
that's good. Which is cool because it ties into the very first X-Men film where you know that Magneto and Xavier have history. Mm-hmm. And this is that history, even though we're just seeing it as a 2011 film as opposed to a 2000 film.
Yeah.
So long way to wait for that, but it was good.
Yeah, First Class, definitely one of my favorites. So
yeah, and I'll segue right off of that because my number four is First Class as well. And for same thing. I thought that Michael Fassbender as Magneto, you know, nothing against Ian McClellan, but, you know, in the comics at least, or even in the cartoon show, Magneto is someone who's very old and has aged incredibly well as an Omega class mutant. And I thought that, nothing against his age. I think he's great. He does a fantastic Magneto. But I thought it was good to see Michael Fassbender, a younger actor, portray Magneto. I thought to me it felt more appropriate.
That's the only thing about the original three that kind of confused me as a kid. I was like, why is he so old?
Because you see him in like the 90s cartoon show.
He's like really daunting in the show, and what I remember,
he's not just daunting, he's physically imposing. He's a big guy.
But like, he's got like that really cool helmet, and sometimes it would be like dark so you could barely see
the best
eyes.
Helmet ever, arguably.
Maybe. It's a really good one. My number three is Deadpool. Really surprised me, actually.
I'm surprised here it's this high on your list.
Yeah, well, I was late to the game with Deadpool. Okay. I heard a lot about it before I actually saw it. I did not expect it to have so much heart. Obviously, it was hilarious.
Yeah.
Ryan Reynolds is Deadpool.
Yes.
He plays that character perfectly.
He did well.
But I don't know, the stuff with his wife...
that I cared. You're right.
Yeah.
I cared about
it. It was really good. So it brought that extra emotional element for me.
Yeah.
And when you're in a good mood, when you're laughing and stuff, it hits you harder when that emotional stuff kicks in.
I don't want to, mistake credit where credit's due. I feel like she was actually kind of funny in the film as well.
Oh, yeah. No, and their chemistry was actually great.
They've got to probably have off-screen chemistry. Are they dating? I don't know. Who knows?
No. He's married to
Blake Lively.
Yes, I know celebrity stuff. It's kind of embarrassing.
Okay.
Okay, we'll cut that out.
All right. Anyway, so my number three is...
Let's hear it.
X2 is my number three. Yeah, X2.
Interesting?
Okay. X2 is my number three, and I think it deserves to be this high on the list because there were so many characters brought in X2 that I would have liked to have seen in X1. Giant-sized X-Men characters, which is also one of the best X-Men runs ever. They didn't have a lot of screen time. Some of them did, like Nightcrawler. But even if it was just for a glance during, the William Stryker house raid on Xavier's mansion, we got to see a little bit of Colossus. Mm-hmm. And, I like to see some of those giant-sized characters. And I thought Nightcrawler was awesome in that movie.
Yeah,
Nightcrawler.
I'm just gonna talk about my number two.
Okay,
For it. This is my number two favorite film.
All right,
X2.
That's
number two for me.
Is that next? Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
It was kind of a weird transition. I'm sorry.
That's fine. It works. It's a great movie.
Yeah. Anyways, that Nightcrawler scene in the beginning.
Yes.
Kicks it off so well.
Yeah, it's awesome.
It's awesome.
I love when superhero movies do that, where you just pick up. And that's what you get. You get action right out the gate.
Yep.
I love that.
And the only thing that kind of bothered me with Nightcrawler was how serious and like nervous he was.
Yeah, because he's a comical guy.
Yeah.
In the comics.
In the comics, he's pretty funny and stuff and, and smooth.
Yeah.
And he's always kind of like flirting with the other X-Men ladies, right?
He is religious, though.
I think.
Which they didn't get down because he is Catholic.
Yeah.
Yeah. Coming from Germany, he has strong Catholic roots. Mm-hmm. And I like that they brought that element to his character. Yeah.
But overall, he was a great character, and to kick off the movie with that scene in the White House was great. And once again, still holds up.
And
today,
I love that damn scene at the end of the movie. Everyone's gonna hate that I just did that play on words. The damn scene. At William Stryker's Fortress. I knew it would. Yeah, where they're doing, where they're doing Weapon X stuff at the dam on the Canada and American border. It actually, to be fair, it has been a long time since I've seen X2, and it's still this high on my list. because that's how fond of memories I have of it.
Yeah.
But I'd have beef with it, Corey, because it did kick off the wrong start of the Phoenix saga. Hey,
it started right, though.
Kind of.
Right?
I mean, no, they're not in space.
Well, you take what you can
and
get.
And you have, like, you don't see
Hey,
this,
that
like,
was a great death.
It was a good death.
Wasn't it?
Yeah. I mean, you see her, you actually see her telekinesis be pretty dang powerful, which at this point in the comics, if she's this far along, her telekinesis is pretty developed. And I just spit all over Cyclops.
How dare you?
Yeah, he likes it. And all right. But anyway, I'm going to segue off you and go into my number two.
Okay.
And my number two is Logan.
Wow.
Logan is high on my list. Yeah.
Great.
And I feel like I can't talk about it in the depth that I want to. I loved Logan. Mm-hmm. I'll talk more about it in our review, which is going to be up right now, as you said.
Yes.
But so I don't want to jump right into it too much. But
that's crazy that you can put it at your number two spot right now. I don't know. For me, since I just watched it, it's higher on my list.
I've been marinating in it a lot and thinking about the movie since we saw the premiere last night, and I loved Logan. And it's hard for me to talk about on this list because this is a superhero movie list, and I'll just say one of my things, I don't think that Logan is even a superhero movie. I don't think it is. I think I think it transcends comic book movies and superhero-dom. But we'll talk about that more later. Why don't you go ahead and do your number one?
All right. Well, I think we both have...
Do we have the same number one?
The same number one?
We do. We have the same number one.
By Let's process say it elimination. Together.
Hey, did you ever do that in school? Process of elimination? That's how I know what you have.
Yeah. It's crazy, man.
I did it
it's
with
crazy
ten,
how you can
I did
do
it with
that.
10 things, though. It's pretty good.
You're a talented guy.
I know. I've been told.
All right. Let's say it together.
Days of future past. All right, so
that's why we're the losers.
All right, yes. All right, go ahead. Why don't you talk a little bit about Days of Future Past?
Days of Future Past for me is the best, just most perfect. It's the perfect X-Men film. You get the old crew with X-Men with the first three X-Men films.
Yep.
You get, you know,
the
Wolverine going in, Wolverine going into the past and wiping the mistakes away completely,
which was perfect.
And also, we get, you know, another taste of those new X-Men characters, the new, you know,
and we
James
get some,
McAvoy,
and you know, at that remote location they're in when they're in China, you get to see some characters that you don't see all the time, like Warpath. Like, that was cool. They brought in some, you know, peripheral characters of the X-Men universe that, you know, fans would recognize. But you know,
and it was great to see Fassbender, you know, Magneto, and Professor X at the end, you know, in the, you know, the older versions of themselves working together.
Yeah.
Because of, like,
the Sentinel threat.
The Sentinel threat that was going on.
Which is Trask.
Really
right?
Cool.
Is that Trask? I forget.
Yeah.
Yeah, Trask.
Yeah, it was good.
That's cool. All right. Well, yeah, I 100% agree. That's the number one. Definitive, Days of Future Past is the best X-Men film. I agree.
Thanks so much, guys, for tuning in.
Yeah.
We are the losers. You can catch us every week with our weekly show with a new topic.
Yeah, this is our first episode ever, so be sure you guys leave a like, and if you want to
subscribe, please.
You'll be one of the first, so that's fun.
Yes.
This is a consistent thing that Corey and I will be doing with the losers, so be sure to do that. And if you want to watch our Logan review, it's up right now. Yeah, it's up right now, so go watch that, and we'll talk about it more in depth since we weren't able to right now. So thanks
Go
again.
Check it out. Go watch it.
Thanks for watching.
Peace.